Morning has come, arise and greet the day. Dance with joy and sing a song of gladness. The light of hope is shines upon each face. May it bring faith to guide our journey. A new day dawns, once more the gift is given. Wonder fills this moment shared together. The light of peace here shines upon each face. May it bring faith to guide our journey home. Open our eyes to see that life abounds. Open hearts to welcome it among us. The light of love shines upon each face. May it bring faith to guide our journey.
Good morning and welcome to Live Oak Unitarian Universalist Church. It's so good to be together again, and it's so great to have this place where, even with all of the craziness in the world that is happening right now, all of the things that could legitimately make us scared, we have this time once a week to be reminded of our highest values and to be with others who share those values. This month, we are talking about the continuum between imagination and reality, because we know that we need elements of both if we are going to be able to do our best thinking and planning. And today, we have something special. It is the tradition of the Free Church that we honor the wisdom of all of our members, not just the clergy. We know that we all can learn from each other. And so today we have four members who are effectively taking the online pulpit to share some of their thoughts about our monthly theme and the whole idea of that maybe we should have hope that the tide is turning. If you are new here, I want you to know that you are especially welcome. I understand that trying to become part of a community right now while we're all online is kind of a strange thing, but I want you to know that you are eagerly welcomed here. And in fact, after the service, we have a Zoom room that is set up just for you. You'll find the link at liveoaku.org. It's called Just for Visitors. There'll be just a couple of Live Oak members who were there. Kind of imagine if you were coming to our physical church and they were standing at a table, you could walk up to them and ask any questions that you might have. So we invite you to go to that. Also, you'll see that there is a form. Again, the link is at liveoaku.org. If you'd like more information about Live Oak, you can click on that. It is tradition in Unitarian Universalist churches to begin our gatherings by lighting a flaming chalice. And so if you have a candle or a chalice near, please draw it towards you as we all light our chalices together.
We are building a new way. We are building a new way. We are building a new way. Feeling stronger every day. We are building a new way. We are working to be free, hate and greed and jealousy. We are working to be free. We can feed our every need. We can feed our every need. We can feed our every need. Start with love that is the seed. We can feed our every need. Peace and freedom is our cry. Peace and freedom is our cry. Peace and freedom is our cry. Without peace, the world will die. Peace and freedom is our cry.
Good morning. My name is Carrie Krause, and I'm the Director of Lifespan Faith Development here at Live Oak. I'm so happy that you joined us for worship this morning. Today's big idea is The Whisper by Pamela Zabarinsky. There once was a little girl who loved stories. She loved how the words and pictures took her to new and secret places that existed in a world all her own. The characters became her friends, and quite often she grew to love them. One afternoon, while waiting for school to be dismissed, the little girl noticed a mysterious book perched high up on a single shelf. "What's that book?" she asked her teacher. "That is a magical book of stories," replied her teacher. "It was a gift from my grandmother when I was just about your age. I have an idea. Would you like to borrow it for the night?"
"Oh, yes, please. Thank you," said the little girl, just as the clock struck 3.
The teacher gave her the book, and with great anticipation, the little girl sprinted out the door and ran all the way home. Once home, the little girl greeted her dog and ate supper, and when she was just about to burst with excitement, she escaped to her room to read. The little girl opened the book and began turning through the pages one by one. Each picture was more beautiful and curious than the next. But by the time she arrived at the very last page, she could scarcely see, for her eyes were filled with tears. Where were the words? Where were the stories? It's just not a book of stories without any words, she thought. As the little girl paged through the wordless book, she heard the wind blow and then a small whisper. "Dear little girl, don't be disappointed. You can imagine the words. You can imagine the stories. Start with a few simple words and imagine from there. Remember, beginnings, middles, and ends of stories can always be changed and imagined differently.
There are never any rules, rights, or wrongs in imagining. Imagining just is. The whisper sounded so knowing and wise to the little girl that she opened the book to the first page and began. At first it felt difficult to imagine a story, so she looked harder at the picture. Are the bears best friends? She wondered. Maybe the blue bear is bringing honey as a gift. Bears love honey. Blue Bear's Visit. Now that's a good title, she thought. And then she began to tell herself a story. Blue Bear arrived on the first day of spring. He promised. The little girl studied the second picture. There's that little rabbit again, she thought. I wonder what that man is saying to the magnificent ox. I know. The secret. Mr. Ox, you must please promise not to tell anyone, but we need your help. Last week... The words began to come more and more easily to the little girl. And then the words grew into sentences, and the sentences became stories. The quest. Their 100-mile journey began in a sturdy wooden boat. Are we there yet? Asked Rabbit. In another 2 days and one night, replied Lion. Oh, that's a very long time. I forgot. Please remind me again. Where are we going? Asked Rabbit. Tiger's Prayer. All the creatures of the land, near and far, would be coming, and preparations were being made. The clown in the pointed hat would play music on his accordion. The wind horse would jump through hoops. Tea would be served exactly at noon, for Tiger had something important to say. A birthday party. As instructed, we arrived at exactly 3:33. One four-leaf clover and a large pot of hot steeping tea had been purposely placed near the entrance of the woods. An owl perched in a tree to our left asked, "Hoo-hoo!" and we promptly answered with the secret password. Our job was to bring the birthday cake, vanilla with vanilla cream frosting and black raspberry filling, with exactly 6 candles on top. Pan was very particular, and you could never quite know what to expect, but he insisted on throwing the surprise birthday party for the magical cloak. One night, a mysterious man in an elaborate cloak sailed into our harbor. Quite quickly, it became obvious to us that he was some kind of wizard or magician, for he could blow bubbles in the shapes of things. What was even more extraordinary was that the bubbles, once released, became real. Before long, enormous white whales filled our once calm harbor. Amazing as it was to see, we had to do something quickly to... The Golden Key. That very morning, Owl told us he would pick us up at midnight. We must be on time and prepared for anything. He held the small golden key tightly in his beak as we flew into the indigo night sky. We were ready to face... Word by word, hour after hour, the little girl imagined an entire story for each page. And when the moon was full and bright, she grew sleepy and drifted off into a dream world woven out of the threads of the pictures and the stories she had imagined. When she woke, the little girl felt grateful for the small, knowing whisper. Already she missed her new friends, the ox, the owl, and the tiger. She yearned to open the book once again, but the sun was up over the horizon, and the birds were already fluttering about, chirping their morning songs. She did not want to be late for school, so she tidied herself, scooped up the book, and rushed out the door. Along the path, she met a fox, holding a curiously round package.
"Excuse me, little girl," said the fox. "I believe I have the words to your book. I saw them spill away, and because I am a very clever kind of fox, I caught them in my net just before they drifted too far off."
"Oh, thank you," replied the little girl, feeling a little bit confused.
"Now, please, before you leave, could I bother you for a small favor?" asked the fox.
"Why, of course," answered the little girl. The fox thanked the little girl, and the little girl thanked the fox, and she gathered the book and the bundle of words and hurried off down the path towards school once more. "I'm so sorry I am late," said the little girl, still catching her breath. "There was a whisper, and I imagined stories for every picture, and I overslept, and the words, I didn't know that they had fallen away, but the clever fox caught them in his net, and, but I loved your book, and I almost forgot. Thank you. I have so many stories to tell you."
"I can't wait to hear," replied the teacher with a smile. The Fox and the Grapes. A famished fox saw some clusters of ripe black grapes hanging from a vine. She resorted to all of her tricks to get them. But this fox was of the very clever kind, so she imagined her story differently, and the grapes tasted ever so sweet. The end.
Mother, I am young. Mother, I am just 18. I am strong. I will work hard. But I do not want this child to grow up just to work hard. What must I do to make a different world for her? Where do I start?
The secret lies in the reading and the writing. You can read. Every day you must read one page of a good book to your child. Every day this must be until the child learns to read. Then she must read every day. And you must tell the child the legends that I told you, that my mother told to me, and her mother told to her. You must tell the fairy tales of the old country. You must tell of those not of this earth who live in the hearts of the people. Fairies, elves, dwarves, and such like. You must tell of the ghosts that haunted your father's people, and of the evil eye which put a hex on your aunt. You must tell of the signs that come to the women in our family when there is trouble and death to come.
Mother, I know there are no ghosts or fairies. I would be teaching the child foolish lies. Why, when I myself do not believe?
Because the child must have a valuable thing, which is called imagination. The child must have a secret world in which live things that never were. It's necessary that she believe. She must start by believing things not of this earth. Then, when the world gets too ugly for living in, the child can reach back and live in her imagination. I myself, even in this day and at this age, have great need of recalling the miraculous lives of the saints and the great miracles that have come to the earth. Only by having these things in my mind can I live beyond what I must live for.
The child will grow up and find out things for herself. She will know that I lied. She will be disappointed.
That's what's called learning the truth. It's a good thing to learn the truth for oneself. To first believe with all your heart, and then not to believe, is good too. It fattens the emotions and makes them to stretch. When, as a woman, life and people disappoint her, she will already have had practice in disappointment, and it will not come so hard.
Thank you. used to think the world was flat. Rarely threw my head into the crowd. I felt I had used up my quota of yearning. Used to look in on the children at night, in the glow of their Donald Duck light, and frighten myself with the thought of my little ones burning. But oh, the tide is turning. Exclusive to moonshots and world title fights. Jesus Christ, imagine what it must be earning. Who is the strongest? Who is the best? Who holds the aces, the east or the west? This is the craft our children are learning. But oh,
so I was thinking about it. Imagination and reality. So on the one end, you've got imagination, what we think in our minds, the ideas that we come up with, you know, just our inner creativity. And on the other side, you've got reality, you know, the world that we're living in, the set of actions, you know, that we follow, you know, the concrete, tangible things. And I don't think that they're opposites necessarily. I think that they are two parts of a continuum. And I say that because so much of our reality stems from what was someone's imagination first. For example, this computer that I'm recording on, the electricity, the architecture in this room right now, the, you know, drawing that my friend made, the plant, you know, it was all things that someone came up with first in their mind and then created it, and it was manifested, and now it's part of my reality in this room right now. In addition to the Wi-Fi connection that I'm using, you know, what if there was a way to communicate, you know, Wi-Fi, the internet, electricity? But it all started out as just imagination first. So I think that reality is a lot of imagination that's just been manifested into like a physical form or into a like a tangible form, whether it's via airwaves or the radio or whatever. I don't really know how it all works. But I will say that the thing about that is, you know, for envisioning a better world, we can, you know, we can use our imagination. You know, we can see the world as it is now with, you know, man, society and the environment and politics and human rights. Oh my gosh, man, the list just goes on, you know, and there's a lot of bleakness, you know, there really, really is. But I think that we can have hope and that we can use our imagination to see what would be possible, not just the darkness that prevails now, you know, but, you know, what could our lives look like? What could, you know, even people that we don't necessarily think of, you know, throughout our everyday life, you know, refugees, you know, people that, I don't know, people that live in third world countries, you know? You know, imagining a reality where things are good for all of us, you know, not just, you know, not just the wealthier places like the United States. Man, that is just like, even thinking about that right now, just to be honest, it's just like amazing. And it would just be incredible. You know, but you got to hold it first. You know, you got to have that, you know, belief that it is possible first. Otherwise, you just get more of what you got. So I think that, you know, imagination is like the seed that will grow with, I don't know, with work, with effort, with passion, with just, you know, persevering and striving. And, you know, enough people get it and it just can become something real, you know? Whether it's from music or art or, you know, buildings or just like whatever, just like social change, you know, hybrid cars, you know, like, I mean, it's crazy, but it's totally possible. And I think that it is worth having hope, you know, and using our imagination to believe that things will change and get better and what things could be possible to get there, you know? I absolutely think that that's one of the most valuable things we can do. And, you know, just think of it as a continuum. Just starting point here is imagination, you know, with hard work, effort, you know, spreading the idea, it can manifest as something real and tangible. So those are my quick thoughts, you know. Hope you have a wonderful day. Peace out.
I've noticed lately that things have happened before that are worse than what's going on right now, though maybe not in my lifetime. And even though it's super sucky right now, there is possibility for massive change. Like workers who need to telecommute are starting to be able to get those accommodations that they've needed for so long. Distance and online colleges are so much lower cost, but they're also starting to be able to get recognition. Maybe these students who have been needing distance learning and workers who've needed distance work and online commuting for so long are going to finally be able to get these accommodations. The world is also starting to wake up to injustices that have been the elephant in the room for too long. One of the things I use to battle my anxiety is that when it starts going off on all the bad possibilities, I have to try and shift its energy to focusing on all the possibilities that could be wonderful or even partially good too. Anxiety gives me a great superpower in thinking of the what-if situations. So if I can redirect it to what if this turned out really good, a lot of times it brings me a lot more hope than I would have thought. I can use it for just going to the grocery store and thinking about all the different things that could go wrong with a trip to the grocery store right now. Like, you know, normal times even, I could get in an accident on the way there. I could get there and get coronavirus from touching the grocery cart. Or I could go there and somebody could make me super uncomfortable by standing just a little bit too close. You know, that's not quite 6 feet there in the line to check out. And I can get really bottled up in all of this, but I can also start thinking about what all the possibilities are good and great that could come out of this, or even just partially good. You know, I could drive there with no incidents and I might be listening to my favorite song, or I could just be able to enjoy a few moments of absolutely wonderful silence that I haven't really gotten that much since I've been holed up in my apartment with my husband and kid. I could get there and find a perfectly sterilized cart just waiting for me to use. I could go inside and find that my favorite treat is on sale, or I got to see somebody who just doing their own grocery shopping that I know and I haven't seen for a while, and I might be able to catch up with somebody face to face. You know, maybe 6 feet apart, but still face to face. I could end up in all of these awesome possibilities, but I could also start looking into the future of what if we end up in a world with affordable education for all, because we've been able to test out distance education during this pandemic. What if we're able to focus on the good? Like, what if in the future we end up where people who have disabilities can get their accommodations taken care of, like telecommuting, without being laughed out of the office because it's normal now? What if we have these awesome possibilities for the future where people who are rising up against injustice are actually listened to? Where people who are hurting but end up saying something are listened to. And, you know, my anxiety superpower can keep me in the negatives, or I can refocus it and look at these positives that could be coming our way. And I have to make sure that I stay focused and I don't attach myself to these possibilities, because that's all they are, possibilities. But if I can give myself the hope that these possibilities still exist, then I can help change my outlook for today, and I can get myself to a better place for now. And if I'm in a better place for now, then I have a better outlook on the future. And if I have a better outlook for the future, then I'm probably going to do more to try and achieve that today.
It seems now more than ever, people are more aware of societal issues. People I know that normally turn a blind eye to political, social, environmental, economic issues, they're talking about them. They are in no way experts on the issues, but they're starting to engage by reading what experts have to say. It appears focus has shifted. What matters has shifted. More and more, I hear people saying, we as in all of us, not just our small social bubbles or influence, but humankind. Awareness is growing and intensifying, waking us up to what is most precious. Life. The tide is turning. Our connections are so important right now. We are stronger together. Many of us are quarantining. Despite that, we are still connecting with others and even making new connections or reconnecting. In our solitude, we have found ways to keep in touch with our technology. We're listening to each other's stories and then sharing them. It's powerful. We are powerful. And speaking of connections, the way this church has stayed united is amazing. When my mom passed away, I didn't feel alone. I desperately wanted to be held, and that came in the form of cards, emails, phone calls, Zoom calls, and even baked goods delivered right to the door. That brought me so much hope. I love you all. And you bring me so much hope.
Can I tell you something? The world is kind of a crazy place right now. Seems like there's an endless barrage of bad news. How can this be happening? You know, it's easy to fall victim to the negativity. It's easy to lose sight of the fact that there are reasons to have hope. Sometimes it's the simple things, nature, taking a walk, feeling the breeze, seeing the trees, hearing the birds. There's something reassuring and hopeful about seeing the continuance of life in the natural areas. People give me hope. People facing adversity, doctors, nurses in the ICUs, taking care of desperately ill people. Some of them tape pictures to the front of their protective equipment so that a patient can see that there's a real human being behind that mask and goggles and stuff. Parents and teachers facing the uncertainty of getting their kids back to school, virtual school, home school, school in person. Yeah, that's not easy, but they're not giving up. They're getting it done. The Black Lives Matter protest movement brings me hope. People peacefully marching in the streets, bringing attention to police brutality and racial injustice. You know, 2 or 3 years ago, an NFL quarterback, Colin Kaepernick, took a knee during the national anthem. He was just making a statement at protesting police brutality. Well, the man was reviled. I mean, it was like, how dare he kneel during the national anthem? That's treason. He must be a traitor. Now look how far we've come. Entire sports teams are kneeling, postponing games. Canceling games, the NBA canceling, postponing games, Major League Baseball canceled a game, WNBA, I think, postponed or canceled their season. I think the message is they want you to stop watching them and take a little time to reflect on things that are a little more important. That there are more important things than sports. And I think people are slowly getting it. It's not okay to just say, well, I'm not a racist. You somehow gotta go to the next step. You gotta become anti-racist. And there's hope, and I think people are getting it. You know, there's an election coming up, and there's a reason for hope. You know, it's time for a change. The divisiveness, the corruption, it's got to end. I know efforts will be made to suppress the vote. Some will question the process. It's not going to work. The tide is turning. You know, the people that perhaps give me the most hope of all, it's you guys. It's the people of Live Oak Unitarian Universalist Church. Ordinary people doing extraordinary things. Reaching out to the community. Distributing food to the less fortunate. You know, taking care of each other. Yeah. And as I am often reminded, I am not alone. Therefore, I have hope. Thank you.
hi again. To our members and friends and supporters of Live Oak far and near, I wanted to give a quick message about stewardship. It is that time again. This is when members recommit to the church, and we could use all the support we could get right now because, frankly, it is a difficult year. I talked before about us being part of the free church tradition, and that's very important. There are no powers on high that tell us how to run our church. We vote for our officers. You even voted on the minister to call. We make our own decisions. But the free church does not come free. Along with not getting bossy orders from above, we also do not get money from above. All of the money that we use to run this church and to do the things that we do in our community come either from pledges or from rentals. And because of COVID, those rentals have taken a significant hit. And so we really need your help so that we can continue putting more love into the world. And look, money is a hard thing to talk about. I am very awkward talking about money, but it is the reality of the situation. And so here is our ask. If you support this church, even if you are not a member, if you support what we are doing in the wider community and within our walls, the way that we are working to create a safe, inclusive space for everyone, then I ask you to consider making a donation, a pledge to Live Oak. Maybe it's just for a few dollars a month, but every single dollar is appreciated, and we scrutinize our budget to make sure that we are making the very best use of the funds that we have. If you are a member who can do this, I ask you to consider increasing your pledge this year. Not only do we have a deficit caused by the rentals that we usually depend on, but some of our families, COVID has affected them and their employment, and so they're having to decrease their pledge. So if it is possible, please consider increasing your pledge this year. Know this, no matter how much you give, it is so very important. Every dollar goes to helping us to fulfill our mission in the world. Thank you so much for your support and for cheering us on and for being a part of this community. Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. A special thank you to everyone who helped make this service possible, our readers, Sylvia and Ashley, and today's preachers, Darius, Jesse, Liz, and Ray. Thank you so much for bringing your gifts and your wisdom so that we could share in them. And now please join us for our fellowship time. If you go to liveoakuu.org, you will see a link. It says fellowship time right there. It's going to take you to a Zoom room where we can all see each other's faces and we can have some deeper check-ins and see how we're all doing. I hope that you have a wonderful week this week, or a good week. Maybe let me just kind of lower the bar. I hope that you have a good week. I hope that you have moments of patience when you need them. I hope that you can find some times for peace and for relaxation. And I hope that you can connect with others, because it's important that you know that you are not alone. And as you go forward, may you carry with you courage, cheerfulness, and resolution.
Soon the day will arise when we will be together, and no longer will we live in fear. And the children will smile without wandering weather. On that day, thunder clouds will appear. Wait and see what a world there can be if we share, if we care, you and me. Wait and see what a world.